My name is Chris Eversoll, and this is my colleague Mark Ritchie. We're here with AuST Development, and we're going to just talk a little bit about our experience implementing Odoo in our company. When we initially began working with Odoo, obviously it was not particularly well known, at least here in the local area, and one of the things that sort of pushed me over the hump to make a commitment to the platform was speaking with another company that had implemented, and that kind of gave us the confidence to proceed. So in that vein, we thought we would take a few minutes to share our experience, and hopefully some of you find it interesting and or helpful. So just briefly what we'll talk about, we'll give a little background on the company, which is called AuST. This is not technical, this would be kind of our experience, so status of where we are and where we want to get to. Our assessment of the platform strengths and opportunities, at least in our particular implementation and within the constraints and necessities of our business. And then maybe talk a little bit about some of the customizations that we've made to help work in our in our particular environment, in conjunction with some great partners who've helped us to do that, and then a few minutes for questions if there are any. So the AuST group, we are a developer of medical devices. We have a small group of companies. We're vertically integrated. We take the cycle from the design, early design of products, through manufacturing and finished device distribution, although generally speaking, we're working with large OEMs, large multinational companies who are distributing the products. So we're producing and they're sending them out to the market. We our technical area of expertise is minimally invasive delivery systems and catheter-based products. So these are things that would go into blood vessels, into the heart, sometimes into the brain, lungs, anywhere you need a long skinny tube to get there and do some sort of procedure. And we have a little sampling of some of the products that we've designed and worked on. And so, you know, as you see, they're all long skinny tubes. But for example, in the bottom right-hand corner is a delivery system for a minimally invasive aortic valve, which would basically replace an open heart surgery. In the middle bottom is a pump that can temporarily support blood pressure, cardiac output, if someone's heart is not able to generate that for themselves. Above, you'll see those gold-tipped ablation catheters, which are used for treating arrhythmias. These are the kind of things that we make and design. And so it's a, you know, it's an interesting, at least for us, manufacturing environment where we have a relative degree of complexity. You know, products like that may have a BOM of 50 parts. All of them are custom made to our specifications and then assembled, and the volumes are quite low. And the attention to detail and documentation requirements are high. And so this is the kind of environment that we work in. We have evolved over the last 10 years of operation into what we call the AuST group. And so we have three operating companies. Development, which is located here in Mountain View, California. Manufacturing, which is our small manufacturing plant in Salt Lake City, Utah. Development does basically from a concept to a first clinical trial. Manufacturing was set up to do component manufacturing, where we're making complex assemblies and sending them to somebody else for finished manufacturing and labeling, sterilization. And then our newest addition, center point, is doing finished sterile medical devices into the market. And even though we're a very small group, 30 people in total, we have these distinctions partly for operational reasons, partly for regulatory isolation between the companies. And so when we were thinking about Odoo, we were trying to figure out how, as a very small organization, we could manage this complexity. that, I've overstepped Mark's the place where I'm supposed to turn the time over to Mark.
That's
so I'm
going
to let
right.
him add his background and thoughts.
So yes, my name is Mark Ritchie. As Chris mentioned, I come from years and years in a consumer products background, manufacturing background. And what I learned during those many years there with very old school ERP and MRP systems was, once you got something set, just leave it. Don't work on it, don't fix it, don't change it, because any of that required a tremendous amount of consulting time, a tremendous amount of money, and even if the new, very often, you know, just upgrading was something that we avoided simply because of the cost associated with doing it. So I come from a background where the ERP and MRP were set, and we ended up with multiple other sorts of databases spread out all over our organization in order to manage things. Very costly, very slow to move because of all those pieces that needed to be connected in a way which just required a lot of labor and was not efficient. The biggest change for me in starting to work with Odoo has been the notion of flexibility and being able to change things quickly and adapt, and it's taken my brain quite a while to get used to that, doing things differently that way. So this next slide attempts to show you where we are in the process of implementation, and I think this is fairly, you know, this is just a quick screenshot. Where we are, it's fairly obvious. We are still in the process of implementing and refining many of the basic apps that are associated with Odoo. So what are we using? The obvious ones: inventory, purchasing, sales management, and manufacturing in a lot of detail. We have touched on many of the other apps that have the hatched mark squares around them because we know that we can grow there, but we haven't spent a ton of time in those. I do think that what this slide is attempting to show is that within the context of our organization, driven by Chris and I in particular, our goal is to make Odoo the frame of reference that the entire organization works from. Our organization currently is very much like my past organization, multiple databases, a ton of time spent connecting information, pushing information back and forth. All of that time spent is waste. We would like to live in a single environment with a single nomenclature, a single way of looking at and thinking about stuff, and we believe that Odoo provides us that opportunity.
So to Mark's point, right now we're partway to our goal of living, you know, exclusively in Odoo. In addition to this, we run still a PLM system for managing product revisions, part revisions, and document control. We run a cloud-based file sharing system in part for those purposes as well. But our long-term aspiration is to move everything into one central location so all that data can be exchanged and can be utilized effectively. You know, when we were looking at Odoo, when we were trying to decide what direction to take, we looked at many of the major systems, at least that seemed appropriate for our realm. We were coming out of QuickBooks. We looked at bolting on Peachtree to QuickBooks. We looked at, you know, the kind of job shop, the directed ERP systems like JobBoss and E2. We looked at SAP Lite, whatever it is now these days, and really none of them felt, most of them felt like, and by the way, neither of us are really technical guys when it comes to programming, but they just felt very, felt like a web interface bolted onto a 20-year-old database, and the only thing that was really somewhat interesting was work that's going on force. A few people building there, but it really wasn't seemed even more technically daunting and more costly, and Odoo was a natural solution for us. And so now 2 years in, we aren't at this vision yet, but we definitely can see it happening within the next 3 to 5 years. I started to speak to the strengths. I think the things that we really appreciate, the ease of deployment is fantastic. You need a browser and you need to give somebody credentials and they're in and working. And so, you know, in our organization, which has no IT infrastructure, nobody to manage things, that deployment is really nice. We really appreciate the speed of the system. We're running on Amazon and even with our mediocre broadband connections, we're running very snappy, and it doesn't feel like it's hard to interact. The flexibility. We came in, from a system where we did not have a lot of legacy infrastructure. I mean, we have very well developed systems for doing product development. They were all geared and developed in single product startup companies, and so they're super efficient if you have a small team, but they're not scalable at all. And so we were really building out how we're going to turn this into a manufacturing organization. And so we've definitely appreciated the flexibility that Odoo provides in that way to move with us as we design our business processes and systems fast, I mentioned. Multi-company feature, so we're running all three companies in one database. That has its challenges. I think the first talk in this session was a little bit about running multi-company. We've had to deal with some issues there, but definitely, overall, that has been a world of improvement compared to running three separate QuickBooks instances or some such thing like this. So we've been quite pleased with that. As we've already talked about, we feel like the platform is very comprehensive.
So thinking about a few areas for us that are opportunities that in some ways perhaps don't mesh perfectly with the current Odoo platform, from a manufacturing perspective at AuST, we have a quality system which mandates a bunch of documentation that supports the manufacturing operation that has to meet FDA compliance and be audited to very strict standards. The result is that almost all of our process at this point is still manual and paper-based. What we are doing is creating, with a bunch of help from a lot of folks, a robust manufacturing platform that's tailored around our needs with the goal of supplanting that paper-based system as quickly as we can, though we acknowledge that that's going to take a while to do. So that very deep manufacturing capability, which we are working on, is the constant area of focus and something that's going on continuously behind the scenes. We've begun implementing MRP so that we can generate raw material requirements rather than just cycle counting and running it through a spreadsheet, which is what we have historically done. Start to use the system for generating material requirements with a move towards the DDMRP model slated over the next 18 months or so. We need to get MRP dialed before we can move on, but the goal is to have everything from forecast and sales orders driving demand, punching down through bill of materials and generating requirements for us. And then, the goal is to replace all paper-based systems. In order to do that, we have to have a validated ERP system, which from an FDA perspective is a very hard thing to achieve because every single mechanism has to be tested and the data recorded so that you can demonstrate that each of those transactions works. And it's certainly a requirement that goes above and beyond most manufacturing operations. So figuring out how to validate the system as we continue to use it is something that we're continuing to figure out how to do.
And I would say, along those lines, one of the other aspects that we thought was appealing, the fact that we have relative control of the code, and when we roll out updates, once we get to that validated state, things are working, we have much more granular control of how things change, and that felt like that was, for a long-term perspective, would be important for us. We've done a lot of customization. I mean, that's one of the great, features of Odoo, is that you can get in and want. It's taken us a lot of learning, and we've had really awesome partners help us do that. I would say that we've found that essential, I think partners are important in two ways. One, just the tech configuration and then modifying. But second, you need people who have an understanding of business processes, industry best practices, and kind of can help merge that into what you're doing, trying to do in software. And, both of our partners in Bovie and Efficent have brought a ton to the table in that way. This is just kind of a smattering of things that we've ended up doing in our, in our implementation to help us out. And, I won't speak in detail unless there are, questions here, but it's an illustration of, of what you can do, relatively quickly. So, we've got an integration with Bartender now that's sending, printed labels straight to the printers. We've got a way to track contracts and tie those to, that's pretty simple. Managing our approved supplier list, so this is a regulatory compliance thing, and, of course, if you're going to buy things from people, you got to control that at the, at the purchasing level, so that's a natural thing to integrate into the database. We've used the U.S. accounting customizations that Novia have developed, and that helps with, some nice features like billable expenses and account reconciliation, and that just makes it a little, a little more seamless to come into an accounting setting if you're, if you're used to QuickBooks, Peachtree, something like that. We do a lot of, and we're evolving in our thinking here, but we came out of a sort of a state where we felt like we were doing a lot of basically made to order. Like, we don't make things unless I have an order for them. We're not, generally speaking, stocking inventory, and so everything we do is highly custom. And we did a lot of work to more closely tie the sales orders to the manufacturing orders and make those things work kind of dynamically, so that if there were changes, they would, flow through before something had gone to the floor. And we're evolving out of that. We sort of, as we learn more and understand how real manufacturers do things, we, understand a little bit better the modularity that you get when you're running big stock. So that's a work in in progress, but nevertheless, we have done a lot to try to meet our, make to order manufacturing, meet our needs there. We have, we have an aspiration to try to get a lot of these, so some of these records that Mark mentioned are in paper, and they're in paper because they have signatures on them, and they give kind of a, a dead end to an audit trail. So, that's a strategic move for regulatory compliance until we're really robust on the digital side. But nevertheless, we want to get all those into all those records scanned into the database. We're working on a smooth flow to link those scanned copies in with the digital records. As Mark mentioned, we're sort of MRP with an aspiration to evolve to DDMRP, and Efficent has been the linchpin there. And then, as we mentioned, we're kind of in this validation world, and so we did some silly little things. We integrated a little logging function into Chatter, where anybody who verifies a record in the database can log a note. It's called a validation note, and then we can subsequently review that and look at it, and summarize those attaching to our validation report and use it to substantiate that the database system is working as expected, and that's to help with our compliance. We issue certificates, of conformance, and this is where we're starting to get into a little more of the, the real nitty-gritty quality world. And so, these and starting to interact with, the compliance aspect. But right now, we just build a module to issue our certificates of conformance after quality signs off, generate those, print them, tie them to the, to the product actually shipped in sales orders. This is coming along. And we've done a bunch of extensions to the maintenance app, which is awesome, with some help of our partners to initiate and organize and follow up on recurring activities like calibration, preventive maintenance, and so forth that we have to deal with. So these are kind of examples of things that readily doable. And, you know, you might, you know, to do that, I mean, I could go sign up 5 different, you know, cloud-based service providers to, you know, provide those equipment management. There's great several companies that do that. You know, you can have those guys do it and, you know, validation, I get somebody else to do that. It would be very easy for us to go in, you know, 10 different directions and all of a sudden have a manageable system. And so we remain quite excited that we can get this into a centralized place.
So thinking a bit about future aspirations, Chris touched on several of them. I think this list could and will go on likely forever. I think there are two things that I have learned in this process over the last couple of years, and they are the following. And they both touch on the culture of the organization as opposed to the systems that support it. We have decided that Odoo is our future. We have proven that we can modify it and customize it to do what we want. Chris and I own the majority of it in our organization. With other people starting to come on board, our goal has to be to move people's mind thoughts, their thoughts and their thinking and the way they approach their jobs away from the disparate, discrete databases that they have been using to run their jobs to the notion that Odoo is the center of the universe. Odoo must be the center of their universe. Everything from the data we collect, how we manufacture it, how we communicate about it, how we analyze it. It all has to be in Odoo. So the onus is on us to get the organization following us in that direction as we move forward. That's number one. And number two is, and I suppose it's a output of number one, Odoo has to be the source of all truth. The data that is true has to come from Odoo, and currently there are too many places that it can come from. We need to be thinking about Odoo and where it is, with a subset of that being the notion, and there's a lean manufacturing idea called stop and fix. The one thing that I have learned from this process over the last 2 years is that you can stop and fix your ERP system just like you can any other system. And it doesn't have to cost $1 million to implement small changes. You can roll them in, you can do it quickly, and you can be flexible and nimble and make the system do what you want. And we need to get the organization thinking around those sorts of ways of doing stuff.
Great, so that's a summary of where we are, some of the ground we've covered. We have a ways to go still, but we're pretty excited about the future, and a little shout out to our partners who have been instrumental in our implementation. So I think that's all we have, and we'd be happy to speak to questions if there are any. I mean, we've been in the regulated world for a long time. You know, it's a relatively small company. We have the luxury of, you know, modifying our systems to kind of, you know, move around and try to be nimble. I mean, it's always a battle. Like, you know, we obviously don't have a huge team to do validations. So we've written kind of a modular protocol, you know, that there's actually a company called Greenlight Guru that did a nice little presentation on this, but it basically, you know, talks about the principles of agile design, you know, in software, and says, look, this is a legitimate way to do it. It's not like, you know, we're gonna pre-plan everything, we're gonna write a protocol, we're gonna test it, and we're gonna give you the data, which is a traditional validation method, right? You, most auditors that come in, they'll kind of want to see that. So we wrote a protocol and said, that's not actually how it happens. You know, we're gonna have a framework. We're going to build continuously. We're going to divide it into functional pieces, not code level, database level pieces. We're going to risk stratify those functional pieces. Like, you know, if I get a PO wrong, you know, okay, so what? You know, if I incorporate the wrong material into a product, it goes out the door, that's a problem. You know? So we risk stratify. And And then we try to, you know, we have sort of a table of things that you might do, depending on the risk of the process that you're validating. And that might range from, you know, basically, you know, the developers look at it and say, hey, that's pretty good, you know, check the box, to, you know, to this this little validation app where we have, we say, hey, you know, for the first month of launch, everybody who runs a transaction, just double check it manually, tell us that it was good, and we'll use that to substantiate to, you know, something that's really mission critical. We're going to write a full protocol, we're going to do a series of test scenarios, and we're going to, you know, we're going to make sure it works and, you know, under, you know, various conditions. So that's kind of how we've approached it. You know, it means that, you know, and we put one or two validations on the books, and we always have something to speak to. So in the back of our minds, we know there's a whole big, you know, world that we have to work on over time. Another question?
Sorry. You mentioned you're building on paper. So where does Odoo end, and like the shop floor processes begin? Like, where are you recording your serial numbers, doing your inventory consumption?
So Odoo assigns all the serial numbers for incoming products or lot numbers. We do mostly lot tracking. So anything that comes in the door is purchased, gets a lot number assigned by Odoo. That's generated with the receiving transfer. And then that follows it through. We put labels on with barcodes. Odoo really maintains the inventory. When we go to the floor, we have a paper traveler, basically, you know, combined bond router, and so all of the lot numbers that go into the builds for traceability are still manual. Our next move there will be to double check. So, you know, after it's manually filled out, somebody will go back, enter it back into Odoo. Odoo will say, hey, that part number and that lot number don't go together, you have an error in your recording, and then the final step, you know, some years down the road will be to do it all electronically. So that's kind of where we are.
So for your COCs and things for when, like, let's say something needs to be audited later, how are you recording those into your system?
Well, this, you know, it's still right now at our stage, we're trying to stop the auditor at the paper, so the CFC would get printed and we'd file a copy of it that's actually signed, physically signed with the you know, with the lot history record, scan it, we go back and reattach it to the lot. We've kind of beefed up the lot log. But already at this time, the CFC is being generated. We built a little thing so that the quality person can enter their password to sign it, so it's, you know, technically 21 CFR compliant. And it's there, but we'll still have that paper, and then as we gain confidence, we'll kind of jettison that. Yeah.
How did you try to decide to integrate with bartender versus the CPO?
Yeah, because I don't know. It is
a better user interface, and it's more robust for certain things. But
we weren't really familiar with either. And, you know, bartender, we did a quick, you know, poll of people, and they said, you know, bartender. We came across bartender quickly, and I was able to, you know, having very little background, you know, make bartender query the Postgres database, and, you know, in a couple hours, and I'm like, oh, kind of works.
Cool.
There were a whole bunch of issues we had to subsequently work out. Like, we had to co-locate the two servers because anywhere else, if they lose connection, it shuts down all your integrations. But you know, once we got through those, it seems to work.
One more question.
Yeah.
Your FPI, that's manufacturing process instruction, right?
Yep.
I'm used to FPI being manufacturing process intelligence. Just, you know, different note. But how are you doing that piece of the puzzle, that process intelligence, process documentation?
That is still largely paper. We're writing MPIs, but we have built a little app in Odoo, which is just kind of a hierarchy of, you know, sections, steps, take a picture, and, you know, theoretically do that on a tablet or a phone and just sit on the line and rapidly document your process. So we have, you know, we're starting to play with that. I mean, we still, you know, write commissioned.
You're able to do that basically in studio yourselves?
No, we
have a partner with that.
When programmed a little bit.
So what the? How many users do you have, and what are your guys' titles?
Principal. I'm the founder of the company, founder and owner.
Director of finance.
Yeah, and we're about 30 people, and we have about half of those people in Odoo. The assemblers line people are not really there, although they'll come eventually, but not there yet. Yeah.
You users that use third-party PLM, do you use like Aras, Arena Solutions, and product like that?
We looked at Arena. We ended up going with Autodesk Fusion Lifecycle, kind of for the same reason. It's pretty flexible. I liked it with some configurations working well. I can already see how it, basically, the only two things you would need to bring that whole thing into Odoo would be a good workflow engine and a good revisioning system. And the revisioning systems there aren't that complex. So. But we use it, we have some rudimentary, you know, they have, both systems have good APIs, so theoretically we can make talk to each other.
And also another question, you're outputting into your COCs, are you also, you have a lot of usage for recording the results for COAs?
Yeah, say that again.
The COAs. Like you're doing COCs to issue the conformance certificates.
Yes. Yep.
But you also deal with COAs.
Like an institutional analysis?
Yeah, exactly.
Like, I mean, maybe semantics. We generally issue them as COCs. You know, we may do some product testing and issue data to the customers as well. We actually set it up in a modular way, so you can design a certificate to associate with any transfer. And you can define the fields that you want to put on the data that you want to pull into it. I mean, not unlimited, but within what we thought would be useful. And you can call what you want, and you can tie it to a sequencer. And so we could very easily just spin up the CVA.
Yeah.
Great. Thanks for the questions.